what I'm about to talk about, at least for a few moments. If my calculations are correct, about four Sundays ago, I preached about this very passage, and I talked about how that God wants to use us and our things and everything that he entrusts to us for his glory.
Do you believe that? God never blesses us with more just for us. He blesses us with more so that we can be a blessing to others around us in some form or shape or another. And so I did something I'd never done before, and that is make a living illustration. And I used some of the warm bodies in this congregation for that illustration. And I'm looking around very, very strongly here, trying to make sure everybody's here. No, they are. I already knew that. I had three guys come up, and I shared some bags of silver in the form of $20 bills with these guys, and I challenged them to see what they could do with money that wasn't theirs. Isn't it amazing how we treat things that aren't ours differently than we treat things that are, right? You ever notice that with your kids? If they pay for it themselves, it's amazing how little they leave it laying around, and it's amazing how they treat it, isn't it? You know what I'm talking about? And so I believe that everything that God gives us is for his glory, and that we are simply the managers of it. That makes a difference, doesn't it? The manager is in charge at the store, at the business, or at the restaurant, or wherever you go, but they're not the one ultimately who makes the decision, ultimate decision on how things are done. That's up to the owner. And I believe that as we had this illustration, I gave money to these three gentlemen that we're going to have come up in just a second. But I believe that as I challenged all of us, even in my own life, and I'm the guy who preached the sermon about it, I know in my own life, God has helped me to take a deeper look at the things that he's given me. I challenged you to take a $20 bill or whatever you could afford, put in a place where you prominently see it and know that it's there and be reminded that what I have is God's and he can use it for whatever he wants to use it for. And I praise God for the growth that I found in my own life in this, and I hope that this is more than just a fun illustration that something we'll remember in our church, but I hope that as you look at what God's given you, the possessions that you have, your children, your grandchildren, everything that God's given you and that he's given me, that we would say, God, it's yours. Amen? It's yours. It's easy to say it, but to do it and to live that way, that makes an awful big difference. And so I am definitely not a master, and these are definitely not my servants or my brothers in the Lord, but I'm going to have them come up here, and let's just see what happened. I'm praying that my money comes back. I really am. No, I believe that these guys have been faithful, and I'll get a microphone here and hold for them since they're all loud guys and not very shy. I know Jeff's not. Why don't we start with Kendrick? Should we start with Kendrick or should we start with Ralph?
Kendrick.
Kendrick? Okay. You want to give an account for what you did with the $20? Do I get my $20 back?
I didn't do anything with it because I couldn't think of anything to do with $20 to
make
money off of it.
That's all right. That's all right. Thank you. You can stay right here because we're going to do something here. How many guys think it took courage to do what he did?
Yeah.
What would you do with $20? Did you hear when I read, by the way, I'm not trying to embarrass you, Kendrick. This guy is a great kid right here. You know that? Did you hear when I read the story, the parable again? Why did the man with the one bag of silver bury it in the ground? He knew how his master was, and he was, what's that word? Afraid. How often in our own lives do we not give what we have to God because we're afraid? You know what I'm talking about? You sense God moving on your heart and saying, I want you to do this, I want you to share, I want you to give, I want you to invest time or energy or your family in this area of ministry or whatever it is, and how many times do we hold back because we're afraid, because we think there won't be enough left for us? Anybody else guilty of that? I know that I have been many times in the past. In our hearts, we say, but what if I don't have enough left for me? Aren't you glad that God is patient with us? and that he loves us. One of these days, this is just a mock parable here. One of these days, we will stand before God, won't we? And we will give an account for everything that he's given us, our talents, our abilities, our finances, our families, our houses, our children, and we will give an account before God. And again, not here to embarrass Kendrick, but I kind of figured that would happen. He's the young guy, and he has the least amount of opportunities. Did you recognize that in the parable? He said he gave them according to their abilities. I mean, Kendrick doesn't leave home a lot of days because he's doing schoolwork and working around the house and all of those things. He's not out and about like some of the rest of us as adults. And so God's going to hold Kendrick to a standard that's perfect for Kendrick. And he's going to hold you to the standard that he's given you. What has he given you? And that will tell you what standard he's going to hold you to and hold me to in my life, okay? Thank you, Kendrick. Your reward is get to keep that $20. All right. Let's give him a hand. Go ahead. You can head back to your seat. I know that was a little bit awkward for him, but I appreciate you playing along there. All right, Jeff. This guy's bold. He must have done something really good. Let us know. Turn it on.
I'm just kidding.
There you go.
Hello? Well, God had a plan for it, evidently. I already helped somebody out financially before this even happened, okay, with $40. And God gave it back to me through him, okay? So I doubled it, and now I have 80 out there, okay? And to see what happens with it, whether it comes back or whether I can get work for it or whatever, or God or whatever aspect he has for it. And I'm thinking, if that comes back, I can double that. And then I keep on helping needy or anybody who needs help, you know what I mean? So we'll see what happens. So that's what we're working towards.
All right, so you gave it away?
Well, I have it.
You have it? Okay.
Yeah.
Can I have it back?
Yeah.
Thank you. Here, thanks for playing along.
What's this for?
It's for you.
All right. Anybody need $20?
To invest in the kingdom. No, thank you, Jeff. I appreciate that. Let's give All Jeff right. a hand. Now, how many bags of silver did the second servant bring back? Two. Or four total, right? He brought back the two that he was given and the four total. Jeff was talking about that you already invested $40 into the kingdom helping somebody. Do you believe that God will bless you if you use what you have for his kingdom? He'll give you enough and even more to use. I believe that he'll do that. And so, Jeff, I appreciate you playing along. With that, I don't want to say playing along, that's a bad way of putting it. It's not a game, but an illustration, because you were reminded of that, weren't you? That $40 wasn't yours. Is this exactly the same 20s that I gave you?
No.
Oh, I didn't think so.
That's the thing. I didn't play along with anything. That all fell into place.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I gave it, so then I was giving it back, you know? They
sure.
Give it.
Sure.
Hmm.
Amen. And God provided for your needs,
yeah.
Right?
I mean, so,
right. Amen. Well, thank you, Jeff. I really appreciate that. And I hope that as you and the rest of us look at our things, that we're reminded that it's the Lord's as well. All right. Here's Ralph.
There are three things that I found very difficult about this. Is one is it's not mine. It's not mine. My first purchase, I went home that night, started getting on auction sites and trying to figure out ways to reproduce and make more money, multiply this. And our first order, I lost money, I think. I bought a lot of stuff in Newcastle. We drove an hour and 45 minutes to get 24 mason jars for $15.85. And I felt like a failure. Hmm. It's just the truth. I felt like now I have to make up for what I lost. Hmm. And the second part that made this difficult was I didn't know when.
Mm-hmm.
This is the first week, and Kim will attest to it, that I brought my talents. And that's not all of them. I got a $20 bill from what we sold yesterday, and I have about $250 to $300 worth of product that we're trying to move in the garage from hustling.
Wow.
And I realized that we have to hustle for God. We have to work. You know, it's not
right.
mine. But what I learned more than that was the stuff we made the most money off is stuff we had to take that was ours, not ours, somebody had given us a resource that people allowed us to have and add what he gave us. So we added the money from the talents to buy materials to restore, redeem,
mm.
and and do that type. So we had to take what he gave us naturally in our mm-hmm. physical abilities, add it to the resources that he allows us to have.
That's right.
We had to take what's ours and what he had, put it together and make it what it is.
Amen.
You can count what's in there. There's 20 more in my truck, and there's product.
Oh, my goodness. Wow. Is that right, what's written on there?
It may be.
243?
That's what it should be.
$243 out of $100. Wow. Praise God. And
praise God.
You say there's even more. That's amazing.
We fell short of our goal. My goal was $77,579.
Wow.
We'll still get there.
Wow. Thank you, Ralph. Thank you. Wow. Praise God. This makes up for the rest of you guys not getting my money. No, I'm just teasing. I'm just teasing. The increase will definitely go to the Lord and for his work. Wow. That's right.
So we can talk about that character. It was amazing. It was
wow.
A fabulous night. I think I waited how many days ago I went, but there's more times than not that I could have
wow.
stood up and praised God for the divine meeting that her and I had. And it was just
it's amazing.
Amazing.
Wow. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. There's a lot of things that we can learn from this little illustration. And one of them, as I look at Ralph, and by the way, I know Ralph and Kim, probably not as well as some of you do, but I've been here for a little while, and I don't know any other human beings on the face of the earth that are any more willing to sacrifice for the kingdom than Ralph and Kim. And I'm not saying this to patronize them. It's just a fact. If you don't know them, you need to get to know them. But the reason that I gave it to Ralph is because I knew of his ability. I knew that Ralph's always, always, as he says, hustling for the kingdom. I like that word. You see, it's not wrong to have things. Did you know that? A lot of times we act like that we have to be poor in order to be Christians, and that's not the truth at all. God used a lot of wealthy people in the Bible. We don't have to be poor. It's not wrong to have things. It's wrong when your things have you. All right? It's wrong when your things have you. And so whenever we look at our lives, and I'm sure Ralph looked at this money a whole lot differently than he looked at the money in his bank account, as he said, it's not his. How would our lives be different if we looked at everything that God's given us consistently and said, it's not mine? You know, with the same thing with Jeff. I knew that he was new, but he had a little bit more opportunity to go out than Kendrick did and do things and all of those things, and he was able to at least not lose it. That's good. But as I look at Ralph and Kim, you know, you're willing to take a risk, right? You're willing to take a risk. How many risks have you taken for the kingdom? Is it worth it? I hope that you see that it is. Because if you take what God's given you and put a little bit of work behind it, look at what else God can do. Look at how many more lives can be touched. Look at the residual effect. I think of Ralph, you did the bench, this was all you, but yet you involved your wife, and now she has the blessing of meeting this new person. Look at how many lives just residually are touched in the kingdom by us being faithful. Your children, your grandchildren, your neighbors. It was simply $100, but now potentially friendships. Now potentially kingdom work done over a little bit of money.
Again, I want to say thank you to all of those who played along and were part of this. And I just want to challenge you as we go forward, and challenge my own heart, to just keep in our minds that what we have is His. It's all His. He lets us borrow it. He lets us use it. He lets us manage it for Him. But one day He's going to give us an opportunity to give an account. And He's a fair judge, isn't He? He's a fair judge. He's a whole lot more fair than I could ever be or you could ever be. And that's why we shouldn't be judging each other, by the way, because He's the judge. And when we stand before Him, the reason He has the authority to judge us is because it was His in the first place. This life, our possessions, everything was His. And I praise God for that. Yes. Amen.
And so as God enables me, I want to keep doing that and just keep that surrender that what I have is His. So anyway, it was really a helpful thing for me.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Anybody else? Just want to share if that was a helpful thing to you or if it... I know. I live with you, though. I know. I did. Amen. Praise God. Amen, Jeff. Praise God. All right. Well, that wasn't my sermon. Some of you are sighing already. No, I hope to not hold you long. I'm not going to speak to you very long this morning. But I do want to share the passage of Scripture that's kind of been the springboard for the series on evangelism. And also, man, if I don't knock those off of here, also extend a little bit on last week's message about prayer and evangelism. How many of you agree that it's God's will that we reach the world? Anybody agree like that about that? Yeah, it's God's will that we reach the world. What other option does God have for reaching people besides using people? In some ways, He's made Himself very vulnerable, hasn't He? Because there's no plan B except for go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, right? And who's involved in that? Who is that? That's us. There is no plan B. Jesus said, I've been given all authority in heaven, Matthew 28, in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you, and be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Even to the end of the age. Last week we looked at Acts chapter 4. We looked at Peter and John going into the temple. If you read Acts chapter 3, you'll see a whole lot more of that. I didn't bring out as strongly as I should have or point out why they were going to the temple in the first place. Were they heading to the temple to heal somebody? Anybody know that story? Why were they going there? You guys know the song, don't you? Peter and John went to pray. What's that? Because they healed somebody. But why were they going to the temple anyway? They were going to pray. By the way, that was at 3 o'clock, I believe, in the afternoon. 3 o'clock in the afternoon for a prayer meeting. We even do a lot of nice things to make prayer meeting easy to attend, don't we? We try to make it on days, or it doesn't really matter where or when. But the point is, in the middle of the day, these guys were heading to pray, weren't they? They were heading to seek God's face, even among people who didn't believe exactly like them, right? Where were they going? They were going to the synagogue to pray. And they were going to seek God's face. Prayer, as Corrie Ten Boom says, and again, applying this especially to evangelism, prayer needs to be our steering wheel and not our spare tire. Do you agree with that? As a church, if there's anything we do, if we do nothing else, if we don't even have electricity, if we don't even have a building to meet in, if we don't have anything, we need to pray. Jesus said, after he ran all the money changers out of the temple, you know, we love that story, don't we? Jesus getting mad and tearing stuff up, flipping tables over. You know, it's an exciting story, especially if you watch it in the film's rendition of that sequence of events. You know, Jesus is doing all this, and we're like, yeah, Jesus, you tell him, yeah, yeah. You know what he said? The reason he was so angry is because he said, my Father's house shall be called what? A house of prayer, and you've made it a den of thieves. Oftentimes, especially in America today, we've made the church a house of singing. We've made it a house of preaching. We've made it a house of entertainment sometimes. Most of the time, American churches have made the church anything but a house of prayer, a house of anything but prayer. And I believe that if we can get back to the age-old truth that prayer changes things, when the church prays together, if they do nothing else, God acts upon that, and God transforms people and churches and communities because of prayer. So my question to you this morning, and this is going to be a little bit more interactive. I told you it was going to be different, so I warned you. Why don't we pray more? As a church, globally, maybe even for your own personal life, you can take it to that level if you want. Why don't we pray?
Because we don't believe it does, it accomplishes much.
Because we don't believe. James says that if we don't have faith, our works don't mean anything. Unbelief? Yes. Amen. Amen. Unbelief.
Impatience.
Because we're too impatient? Okay. Because we live in an instant society? Says, God, we want it now, and if I don't think God's going to give it now, I might as well not ask him.
We also trust too much on our own.
God's our spare tire. We get him out when we need him. We pull out the lucky rabbit's foot and rub it, hope that it gives us some good luck. Now it's our steering wheel. Why else? This side over here has got a lot of points. I don't know about this side. Anybody? Who else? What? Distractions, that's a huge one. Anybody say amen to that? It's one of the biggest reasons that I have a hard time praying sometimes is I have 6 kids. What's your excuse? You know, right? I'm a pastor. What? No.
Laziness.
Oh, watch it now, sister. Watch it. Anybody ever wake up in the morning and know that maybe the Lord's even drawing your heart and you're thinking, oh, I just want to sleep a little longer? Or I just want to do my hobby a little longer, a little more, or I got to go do this other stuff and I don't have time to pray. One person said, I don't have time not to pray because he knows what life's like. Anybody know what life's like when you don't pray? It's a whole lot different than when you do, isn't it? It's a whole lot different. And I'm not being superstitious about this. It's just a reality. It's a lot different if you don't pray. Why else? Anybody else? Why don't we pray?
Inadequacy?
Sometimes
they don't want to put something on God. We're afraid to ask him to do something he doesn't want to do.
Yeah.
Or he may not answer, and he's going to look bad, or we're going to look bad.
Right. Which essentially comes back to a lack of faith, right? That God, if you put it on my heart to pray about this, and I know exactly how you feel. As Francis Chan says, if we need to pray prayers that if God doesn't come through, then we're in big trouble. Because those are the prayers that take faith, right? When's the last time you prayed something that wasn't safe, that you didn't hedge your bet there a little bit? and say, I prayed about that, but Lord, I also worked a couple extra shifts just to make sure that you came through. You know what I'm talking about? But what if God doesn't come through? Would it make a difference? Amen. Anybody else, real quick? Because we're going to go to the next question in just a second. Why don't we pray more? I think it still is. I see you eat sometimes. No, I'm just teasing. Sure. Sometimes it's an embarrassment, or we're easily embarrassed, or we feel like people are looking at us. Yeah. 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 You feel like you're coming back. Anybody else fight against that? If I was a better person, I wouldn't have to ask him for so much stuff. Exactly. Even if you don't ask him for anything, prayer is still worth it, isn't it? What if you knew that God would answer every single prayer that you would ask, that you would pray? I think it was brought up in men's group a few weeks ago. And that, what if you knew that? Would it change how much you pray and how passionately you pray?
Yes.
What if when you prayed for things, you knew God would not answer or give you what you ask for? Would you still pray? Would you still spend time with God even if you knew that he wasn't going to give you anything? Because that's true prayer when you boil it down, isn't it? Spending time with God and communicating with God. Now, the stuff that he gives us and the things that he does for us, that's just an extra icing on the cake, if you will, in my opinion. He's promised to do that. He's promised to provide for all of our needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. But at the end of the day, we pray because God is worthy to be sought, right? And when we seek his face, his hand moves automatically. Sometimes we get that backwards, and I know we talked about that some about that before. When we always seek his hand and we don't seek his face, we get very little or nothing. But when we seek his face, it just automatically happens when we worship him and give him praise for who he is. It's kind of like grits down south, you know? You go down south and you order breakfast and they give you this bowl of grits at a lot of places. Why do they I didn't order that. Well, it just comes with it. It's just, that's just what they do, right? You can give yours to Travis if you don't like grits. He's over there drooling, I think. But God's hand moves. God's arm is strong and he's mighty and he wants to do things for us, but it takes us seeking his face and saying, God, we want to be yours. We want you to be able to whisper and we will run to do your will. He wants to see us be willing and able and ready to obey and to be his hands and his servants. Just like that money was a tool in Ralph's hand and Jeff and Kendrick. Just like that money in all of our hands is a tool for us to use. That's what God wants to use us for. Can he use you? Are you translatable into the economy of the kingdom for God? He wants to use us. The last question, bringing this even down closer to what we're talking about in this series as we wrap this up today, is evangelism. Why? Let me back up. I'm going to have a precursor question here. What is the biggest tool we have to see the lost won to Christ? What is it? Prayer. The church, what's that? Okay. To see the lost come to Christ. What's the biggest tool? What's the biggest weapon that we have to see the strongholds of Satan torn down in people's lives and see them brought into the kingdom of God? And I think Ralph hit the nail on the head, right? It's prayer. Prayer does more than the best witnessing tactics, right? Prayer does more than the best tract that you can leave in a public restroom. Prayer does more than your best ability to gather your nerves and look at somebody and say, Can I tell you about Jesus? Is there a time for all of that? Absolutely. But oftentimes I think we go into this war and the devil's got the big guns and we're breaking out the 22s when we have the atom bomb, if you will, of prayer. When we pray, when the church prays for boldness and sharing the gospel, that's when the place is shaken, amen? That's when God moves, and that's when thousands are added to the church. I'm going to get to see my brother-in-law and sister-in-law. They're in Missouri here in a couple of weeks. We're going to go out and visit them. And I'll never forget, he told me one time, I don't know if it was original with him or not, but he said this. He said, the early church prayed for 40 days, right? They were in Jerusalem. They were there for 40 days, 120 in the upper room, right? Acts chapter 1. They prayed for 40 days. They preached. When they came out of there, Peter preached for about, I don't know, 4, 5, 6 minutes. And 3,000 people came to God. Do you know what we do? We pray for a few minutes and preach for 40 days. And we get very little in return. Amen? I don't know about you, but that convicts me. And sometimes I think it's almost like trying to dig a hole with a shovel and a pickaxe when there's a backhoe sitting right beside us. And God says, just jump on that thing and let that do the work for you. Let that soften the ground. Yeah, there's going to be times where you got to witness. There's going to be times when you got to share. There's going to be times to disciple people. But only God can change people's hearts. Have you found that to be true? There's some people I just want to grab and shake them, don't you? Stop! What are you doing? Look at your life. Look at the choices you're making. You're ruining everything. But only God can change them. Only God can change them. The old adage is you can take a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. And I've said it before and I'll keep saying it. But you can salt his oats. You put salt in his oats, he'll get thirsty. He'll come to the water. Amen? That's what prayer does. God will not drag anyone into the kingdom that doesn't want to come. Ultimately, they have to be able to say yes to God. I know C.S. Lewis said that he came into the kingdom kicking and screaming, right? But that was because in his mind he didn't want to believe, but the evidence was there. And God revealed himself in such a way that he could not resist understanding that yes, God was real, yes, God was true, and yes, God was worthy to be served. And I believe that God wants to do that in many other people's lives. And prayer is the only weapon that we have that will bring down those strongholds. You don't know the reason why we look around and see some of the miracles that we see, even in this church? Prayer. Gail's not here this morning, but if we added up all the hours that she prayed for Katie and Jeff alone, not just our prayers, but just Gail's, be hundreds, I'm sure, hundreds every single day. People that you've prayed for years and years and sometimes decades, is it making a difference? I would have to say yes. It is making a difference. It's not time to quit. It's time to keep praying because prayer changes things. The last question, again, after that precursor, is this. If we know that prayer is our biggest weapon for reaching not only our families, our kids, by the way, I'm not in favor at all of being a part of a church who's all worried about reaching everybody out there and letting our kids grow up as heathens and lost without God. Amen? If we don't win them, we have no right to try to win them. I should say, if we're not busy trying to win our family, our kids, our grandkids, those closest to us, we need to focus on them and then also reach out to those outside. If prayer is that powerful, why don't we pray for the lost more? More. When's the last time that in your prayer time, you just spent a decent amount of time praying for people that don't know Jesus? As compared to, Lord, help me get the work safe. And I'm not making fun. I'm not mocking. I'm just saying, it convicts me when I think of this. Lord, help me to do this and help this to go good and help my trip to go nice and help brother so-and-so as he goes on his. What about the lost? What about them? What happens in the Bible when the church prays for the lost? What happens when the church seeks God's face for the lost around us? I want you to think about something for just a moment. I want you to think of someone, whether a family member or a neighbor or someone that you know, even by maybe they told you or do you just know because of the way that they're living and their actions and activities, that they are lost right now. Think about them. Let someone's name or their face come into your mind. Next question I want to ask you is, do you believe God can save them? And are you being faithful to ask God to salt their oats? You can't do it. You can drag, you can kick, you can convince. And we do all kinds of stuff, right? I told somebody not too long ago that I'll do anything but sin to get somebody to come to church. I mean, I've done it all. I've paid. I've got candy. I've went and done work for them. I did that with Jeff's mom, didn't I? We helped put her door in. She said, "What do I owe you?" I said, "You got to come to church." She says, "Good deal." And she came to church. It's amazing. After I threatened, that's right. If you don't come to church in a month, I'm taking your door back off your house. No, but she did. There's been a lot of people who didn't come after they told me they would, but she did. We're willing to do that. But sometimes when we're willing to do things to get people to come to church, then we are to spend a few moments in prayer and saying, God, change their hearts. Do you remember what God told Moses about Pharaoh? He says, "Moses, you go and I'll worry about Pharaoh." And the Bible says that God melted, or he hardened Pharaoh's hearts, his heart, right? He hardened his heart. If God can harden someone's heart, don't you think God can soften someone's heart too? There's a lot of people around us that I just look at and I think, wow, God, if you change them, you are something else. Wow. We look at them and we think, wow, they're lost. They're a lost cause. I don't see any hope. But we serve a God who is able to soften the hearts of the most hardened people. Get on YouTube sometime and just type in testimonies of changed lives and watch some of the things that you won't believe, some of the people who God's reached when other people had given up. God can change hearts. God can change people. And God can change minds. And so why don't we pray more? The same reason we don't pray in general is the same reason we usually don't pray for the lost. Because we don't believe, right? Because we're too lazy. We're too distracted. We don't believe that God can do it. And to be honest, it's a whole lot easier to just invite them to church. Prayer's hard. But when we realize, when we look at those people that I was just talking about and their names and their faces are before us, and we realize that eternity is forever. Hell is a real place, just like Beloit, Ohio. It's a real place that people go for real forever. And if they are not brought into the kingdom of God, what's their hope? My prayer, and we're going to play a video here. This is David Wilkerson. Some of you have probably heard of him. And he's talking about anguish. And I know that for some of you, this may bring back some bad memories. I don't know. His style is a little bit old-fashioned in some ways, and he gets a little loud and passionate, and that's all right with me. But I'll just warn you up front, it's a little bit different style. But what he's talking about is anguish. I believe that if God can give us anguish in our heart for the lost around us, it'll change the way we pray, it'll change the way we live, and it will change the way we evangelize those around us. So let's watch this together. Listen more like it as we talk about anguish.
And I look at the whole religious scene today, and all I see are the inventions and ministries of man and flesh. It's mostly powerless. It has no impact on the world. And I see more of the world coming into the church and impacting the church rather than the church impacting the world. I see the music taking over the house of God. I see entertainment taking over the house of God. An obsession with entertainment in God's house, a hatred of correction and a hatred of reproof. Nobody wants to hear it anymore. Whatever happened to anguish in the house of God? Whatever happened to anguish in the ministry? It's a word you don't hear in this pampered age. You don't hear it. Anguish means extreme pain and distress. The emotion so stirred that it becomes painful. Acute, deeply felt inner pain because of conditions about you, in you or around you. Anguish, deep pain, deep sorrow, agony of God's heart. We've held on to our religious rhetoric and our revival talk, but we've become so passive. All true passion is born out of anguish. All true passion for Christ comes out of a baptism of anguish. You search the scripture and you'll find that when God determined to recover a ruined situation, he would share his own anguish for what God saw happening to his church and to his people. And he would find a praying man and he would take that man and literally baptize him in anguish. You find it in the book of Nehemiah. Jerusalem is in ruins. How is God going to deal with this? How is God going to restore the ruin? Now, folks, look at me. Nehemiah was not a preacher. He was a career man. But this was a praying man. And God found a man who would not just have a flash of emotion, not just some great sudden burst of concern and then let it die. He said, no, I broke down and I wept and I mourned and I fasted. And then I began to pray night and day. Why didn't these other men, why didn't they have an answer? Why didn't God use them in restoration? Why didn't they have a word? Because there was no sign of anguish. No weeping. Not a word of prayer. It's all ruin. Does it matter to you today? Does it matter to you at all that God's spiritual Jerusalem, the church, is now married to the world? That there's such a coldness sweeping the land? Closer than that, does it matter about the Jerusalem that's in our own hearts? The sign of ruin that's slowly draining spiritual power and passion, blind to lukewarmness, blind to the mixture that's creeping in. That's all the devil wants to do, is get the fight out of you and kill it. So you won't labor in prayer anymore. You won't weep before God anymore. You can sit and watch television and your family go to hell. Let me ask you, is what I just said convicted you at all? There's a great difference between anguish and concern. Concern is something that begins to interest you. You take an interest in a project or a cause or a concern or a need. And I want to tell you something I've learned over all my years, 50 years of preaching. If it is not born in anguish, if it has not been born by the Holy Spirit, where when you saw and heard of the ruin, it drove you to your knees, took you down into a baptism of anguish where you began to pray and seek God. I know now. Oh my God, do I know it. Until I'm in agony, until I have been anguished over it, and all our projects, all our ministries, everything we do, where are the Sunday school teachers that weep over kids they know are not hearing and they're going to hell? You see, a true prayer life begins at the place of anguish. You see, if you set your heart to pray, God's going to come and start sharing your heart, his heart with you. Your heart begins to cry out, oh God, your name is being blasphemed. The Holy Spirit's being mocked. The enemy is out trying to destroy the testimony of the Lord's faithfulness, and something has to be done. There's going to be no renewal, no revival, no awakening until we're willing to let him once again break us. Folks, it's getting late and it's getting serious. Please don't tell me you're concerned when you're spending hours in front of internet or television. Come on. Lord, there's some need to get this altar and confess. I am not what I was. I am not where I'm supposed to be. God, I don't have your heart or your burden. I wanted it easy. Didn't want to be happy. But Lord, true joy comes. True joy comes out of anguish. There's nothing of the flesh will give you joy. I don't care how much money, I don't care what kind of new house, there is absolutely nothing physical can give you joy. It's only what is accomplished by the Holy Spirit when you obey Him and take on His heart. Build the walls around your family. Build the walls around your own heart. Make you strong and impregnable against the enemy. God, that's what we desire.
Amen. That's what I desire. And I believe that if we want to see God move and make us more than just another church on another road in another community in America, that we're going to have to be anguished. And we're going to have to seek His face and realize that this is serious. And I know he referenced television and the internet and those things. He wasn't saying that those things are wrong, and that's not why we're here. Simply saying that there's other things, distractions that just come into our lives and they get the first fruits. And rather than giving God what's right, we give God what's left. Leftovers. And we hope that He's happy with those things. But all along, as we waste time and as we have no anguish for the lost, no anguish for our own homes at times, our own families, people are dying. It is late. And it's serious. And so what I'd like for us to do is very simple this morning as we go to close. If you are willing, would you join me around the front? And Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Just come right on up. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Jesus said, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere. In Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." I believe this morning that God wants to reach our community, not just here, but where you live. And so I want us to pray together that God would help us to be witnesses for Him, first of all, in our Jerusalem. You say, "What's my Jerusalem?" Your Jerusalem, first and foremost, is your family. Have you prayed for your family? Have you cried out to God for the salvation of your children, your grandchildren, your spouse, that God would give them power and strength to live for Him and work in His kingdom? And also, I believe that our Jerusalem is here. It's us, this body of Christ, this local body of Christ. And Lord, help us to be your witness for you. And so let's just pray for our families together and our church, that God would help us to be His witnesses and that we would be used and empowered by the Spirit that Jesus promised. Let's pray. Father, we just come before you this morning and we thank you for the joy and the privilege that we have of calling upon your name. We thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit that is promised to your followers, your disciples, as they go forward and witness for you, that they would be your witnesses, first of all, where they are, where you've planted them. And God, sometimes we get so distracted thinking that we can't change everything around us and we can't change everyone around us that we don't pray for those closest to us. Or we somehow allow our minds to be taken over by the multitude of people that are lost, and it paralyzes us and keeps us from praying. Lord, we want to be a church that is truly evangelistic. A church that reaches out not as a program, but as a principle of who we are, because that's what your church does. And Lord, before we can be an evangelistic church, we need to be a praying church. And God, before we can be a praying church, we need to be praying people and praying families. And so Lord, I just ask right now, as we together cry out to you for our families, Lord, help us to name the name of our spouses, our children, our grandchildren, and cry out to you at least this once. May it be a springboard that makes our hearts hungry to see their salvation, to see their growth, to see their Christian maturity take place. Lord, we cry out to you for our families, for our loved ones, for those closest to us this morning. Lord, we cry out for our church. Lord, it's easy to come and to go and to have Sundays that just go by quickly and we don't really connect with each other. But God, I pray that you would give us a spirit of unity that we've never had at a level that we've never experienced. God, that you would help us to be your witness to each other in our lives. with our families. Make us a testimony of your goodness and your faithfulness to those around us, I pray. Lord, I pray that those closest to us in our homes, in this church, would see Jesus in our lives, that they would see Jesus in our actions, our activities, our words, the things that consume us. May they see Jesus consuming us and his kingdom coming first. Do it, we pray. Give us anguish, Lord, for those that are lost, that are closest to us, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus went on to say throughout Judea, that was a little bit further away. If you were to make circles, there would be the center would be Jerusalem, and then Judea, and then Samaria, and then the ends of the earth. And so those a little bit further away from the center of those circles would be our communities. I believe that God wants to raise up a powerful move of his power and of his spirit in this local community where our church is. You know, a lot of people say, well, you're out in the country, and why are you there, and what's God going to do there? I believe that God's got us close enough to people that we can reach, that we can love, that we can minister to, and that God can help us to bring into his kingdom. And I want you to think right now of where you live, and just call out. If you don't live in Beloit or Sebring, if that's not your address, just call out where your address is, what city or town that your address names. Let's go ahead.
Canfield.
Salem.
North Benton.
Washingtonville. Amen. There's other people who don't attend, or that do attend, but they're not here this morning, that live in other communities. Do you believe that God wants to use you and this church and the kingdom of God to reach them? I don't believe that it's his will that any should perish. And so let's just pray for them. I encourage you to pray for your community right now, your neighbors as they come to your mind, the people that you know in your community. And let's just cry out to God for a move of the Holy Spirit, that we would have this power, that we would say, Jesus, make us your witnesses in this area, in just this Judea that you've given us. Father, I want to pray personally right now for Beloit. I think of the nearly 1,000 people that live here. I think of Sebring with over 2,000 people that live there. God, you've given us, this church, the ability to reach these people. I think of those that are neighbors that they have a Beloit address or a Sebring address, but they don't live in town. And God, we drive past their houses and we see them working in their yards. We see them driving to work. We see them doing various activities. But God, I pray that you would give us a heart and a deep anguish for their souls, Lord. Help us to not be a church that everyone knows where it is, but no one knows anything about. May people know that we are about building the kingdom. May people in this community recognize that there is a place where they can come and find the answers to the questions about God and how to know him. Make us a light. Make us a city that is set on a hill that cannot be hid. Lord, I pray that you would give us a burden and an anguish for these people, those that we've not met. Lord, I think of this coming Friday as we go to the parade, and thousands of people will be there, and they'll be hearing about and seeing our float and the things that we're doing, trying to connect with our community. But God, I pray that more than seeing us in a parade, that they would recognize that there was something different about the people in this church, that we are actually interested in their king, and they're being brought into the kingdom and in their souls and their relationship with you. Lord, I pray for the neighborhoods and the communities of those that have mentioned. I think of Canfield and North Benton and Salem and Washingtonville and Alliance and all of the communities that are connected to this church, God. I pray that you would give us a burden for them. That's how your kingdom is built. That's how your word goes forth. That's how your cause is brought forward, is when your people who are called by your name would humble themselves and seek your face and pray. And so, Lord, we humble ourselves before you. And we pray for our community. We pray for our Judea that you've given us, God. Help us to be faithful. Help us to be faithful, to reach out to them, to love them, and to be a light for you. And then Jesus goes on to say, Samaria. And I know that it's an election year, and all of these things are bombarding the airwaves and the internet and television and radio. But we need prayer for our nation. We need prayer for our nation. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I'm concerned very much about the world that my kids will grow up in, my grandkids will grow up in. But I believe that God wants to use them even greater ways than he's used us so far to build his kingdom. And so let's pray for our counties, our state, our country, that extra ring outside of our local community, that God would send revival, that God would bring souls into his kingdom. Amen. Brother Ralph, would you lead us in prayer for these?
Lord, there's just so much we need from you.
Yes, God.
We're so thankful that we have God that's able to supply all our needs.
Yes.
Through the work that Jesus completed on the cross, through his holy life, through his sacrificial giving and his new blood covenant, the new covenant that was given to us. Lord. We have a nation that's hurting. We have a nation that's wrecked and ruined, Lord, and I think,
Lord, I pray,
as Pastor
for
said,
souls.
We walk through these lives and we drive through these areas and we see the wreckage and the ruin everywhere. Mm. And Lord, I just declare right now that we're not a rubbernecking people.
Yes.
That we just slow down to take a look and gander at the things that are going on around us, Lord.
Yes.
We're a people that will take time to pray. We're a people that we won't call 911 when we see it, but we'll call on the mighty and the holy one.
Yes.
Whose name is Jesus. We won't call AAA to get him out of a jam, but we'll call the Yahweh, the creator of the universe. Mm-hmm. And we'll depend on you because we know that you are where our help comes from, Lord Jesus.
Our help comes from
you. We're in mighty need, Lord Jesus. We have a nation that seems to be turning its back on Jerusalem, Lord, and as a church, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. More so than the peace that a revelation of the one true Messiah would be understood by all that live in Jerusalem, that all the people that are your chosen would know you as Lord and Savior.
Yes.
But Lord, we pray for the leaders, the future leaders, the upcoming, we pray for the kids downstairs that may one day be the congressmen, the senators, the presidents, and the Supreme Court justices of this nation.
Yes, God.
We pray that you put a moral compass in them that can't be turned, that can't be altered, that can't be fabricated to turn a certain way, but that'll always look towards the true north.
Yes.
The one true north, Lord. Yes. All the goodness comes from the north in the Old Testament, Lord. And Lord, I just ask that the people, the leaders of this country, future leaders, as we're going into this season, Lord, that you'd provide them people that would support them, that would pray for them, and that your hand would secure them. Mm. And knowing what we need, if this nation is ever to be great again, it's because we will redetermine to set our sides, our goals, our lives on the one true God, that's Jesus Christ.
Yes.
And we pray praise in his God. Mighty name, amen.
Praise your name, Lord. Praise your name. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Jesus goes on to tell his disciples and those following him that they would receive this powerful spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, when they would be his witnesses to the ends of the earth. There are almost 7 billion people on the face of this planet, and only 2 billion of those people profess anything remotely the name of Christ. Think about that. Every second, people die without even knowing Jesus. And I know that I'm not here to guilt you for being an American. Sometimes we've done that. But I do want to ask you to do this, and that's pray. Pray. We are all involved. We are all responsible. We are all called to make a difference, whether that means we go or that means we support or whether that means we just simply pray. Whatever it is, whatever God's put into our hand, he wants to use. And there are people that you've never met that one day will be in heaven because of your prayers and because of your and my interest in their soul. Countries that we'll never visit and people that we'll never talk to, but God wants to use us to help them. And so let's just cry out to the Lord for the world, the countries around us that are in turmoil, that many of them shake their fist at God. But aren't you glad that God is sovereign above them all? That at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. Amen. Brother Andy, you want to lead us in prayer for these, the nations?
Lord, we come to you today, and Lord, we know that your heart is to spread the gospel, Lord, that lives have changed all over the world. Lord, we know that wherever you have moved in your church, Lord, even in a local church, that in response to the people going out to share the gospel all around the world, Lord, we have so many tools today in our hands to share that gospel.
You've entrusted to us, Jesus.
Just pray that you would raise up people that would have a hunger to see new people come.
Advance your kingdom, Jesus. Use us, I pray.
Just pray that
use us to reach
your kingdom would
Asia, Africa, South America.
Amen. Finally, let's just worship together and believe that God is able to do something. All right, we sang a song last night in prayer meeting. It was beautiful, out underneath the trees and watching the sun go down. And we sang together and prayed together at the Withrow's house. There is power in the name of Jesus. Okay? It just simply says there's power in the name of Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus to break every chain. Do you believe that? There's power to break every chain. Every part of these circles that we've prayed for, our families and our families' lives, our children, our grandchildren, our neighbors, in this community, in this state, in this country, in the world, there is still power in the name of Jesus to break every chain. And then after we sing that through a couple of times, I think that second verse that Ralph brought out last night, there's an army rising up, because that's what evangelism takes. If God is going to reach the world, we have to step up and say, God, use me. However, whenever, wherever, for as long as you want to, use me. And there's an army rising up. Let's sing it together. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Sing that again, Ralph. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
And so, Lord, we recognize that you've called us to a job that is much too big for us. We realize that you've called us to something that drives us to our knees, drives us to humility and recognizing our frailties and our inadequacies. But God, we thank you that there is power in the name of Jesus. And we thank you that as each and every one of us rise up and join this army that is going forward, that we dedicate our lives first and foremost to your kingdom, that we obey the words of Christ that said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these other things that the devil distracts us with will be added to us. And so, God, I pray that you would give us that faith, give us that passion, give us that sense of victory on our hearts and in our tongues as we go forward and spread the good news that Jesus saves, that he can break any chain. Lead us to those people, Lord. Open our eyes to the fields that are already white unto harvest. We pray, God, that you would send forth laborers, and Lord, maybe even that those laborers would be us, that you would use us, God, that you would plug us into your kingdom and make us part of something that is much bigger than ourselves and much bigger than just a nominal relationship with you. Help us to know you. Help us to hear your heartbeat. Help us to have anguish for the lost, and Lord, help us to bring them in. Help us to build your kingdom. And Lord, we'll give you praise. One of these days, we will gather around your throne and we'll give praise and honor and glory to your name because you have broken chains and you've used us to do it as well. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.